Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see all of you. Welcome to worship. We have a baptism this morning, always an exciting thing to have. Welcome to those of you joining us online. At this time, let's rise, greet one another, and start with our opening hymn. Congregation may be seated. Also invite you to open up your hymnals to page 268 for the Order of Holy Baptism, as there will be some portions for the congregation to respond to. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dearly beloved, Christ our Lord says in the last chapter of Matthew, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit." In the last chapter of Mark, our Lord promises, "Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved." And the Apostle Peter has written, "Baptism now saves you." The Word of God also teaches that we are all conceived and born sinful, and are under the power of the devil until Christ claims us as his own. We would be lost forever unless delivered from sin, death, and everlasting condemnation. But the Father of all mercy and grace has sent his Son, Jesus Christ, who atoned for the sin of the whole world, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And what is her full name? Okay. McKenna Faith Urban, receive the sign of the cross upon your forehead and upon your heart to mark you as one redeemed by Christ the crucified. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, according to your strict judgment, you condemned the unbelieving world through the flood. Yet according to your great mercy, you preserved believing Noah and his family, 8 souls in all. You drowned hard-hearted Pharaoh and all his host in the Red Sea, yet led your people Israel through the water on dry ground, foreshadowing this washing of your holy baptism. Through the baptism in the Jordan of your beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, you sanctified and instituted all waters to be a blessed flood and a lavish washing away of sin. We pray that you would behold McKenna according to your boundless mercy and bless her with true faith by the Holy Spirit, that through this saving flood, all sin in her, which has been inherited from Adam and which she herself has committed since, would be drowned and die. Grant that she be kept safe and secure in the holy ark of the Christian church, being separated from the multitude of unbelievers, and always serving your name with a fervent spirit and a joyful hope, so that with all believers in your promise, she would be declared worthy of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
All right, in from ancient times, the church has observed the custom of appointing sponsors for baptismal candidates and catechumens. In the Evangelical Lutheran Church, sponsors are to confess the faith expressed in the Apostles' Creed and taught in the Small Catechism. They are, whenever possible, to witness the baptism of those they sponsor. They are to pray for them, support them in their ongoing instruction and nurture in the Christian faith, and encourage them toward the faithful reception of the Lord's Supper. They are at all times to be examples to them of the holy life of faith in Christ and love for the neighbor. So I'll ask each of you, is it your intention to serve a candidate as sponsors in the Christian faith? If so, then say yes with the help of God. God enable you both to will and to do this faithful and loving work, and with his grace fulfill what we are unable to do. Amen. Hear the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark. They brought young children to Jesus that he might touch them, but the disciples rebuked those who brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was greatly displeased, and he said to them, "Let the little children come to me, and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of God. Assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter it." And he took them up in his arms, put his hands on them, and he blessed them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And we pray together now as our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All right, and I invite all of us to respond together in response to the questions I ask, as a reminder of God's faithfulness in our own baptisms and the blessings that we have received. And so I ask, do you renounce the devil? Yes, I renounce him. Do you renounce all his works?
Yes, I renounce him.
Do you renounce all his ways?
Yes, I renounce him.
And confessing our faith together, I invite you to respond. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth?
Yes, I believe.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried? He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Yes, I believe.
And you believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. And asking sponsors to speak on McKenna's behalf, do you desire to be baptized?
Yes, I do.
All right. Okay, Dad. All right. McKenna, Faith, Erwin, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given you the new birth of water and of the Spirit, and has forgiven you all your sins, strengthen you with his grace to life everlasting. Amen. All right, if y'all will follow me up here, Mom and Dad, and sponsors, if you'll just kind of back up just a little bit. Either way, there you go. All right, this is a big day, obviously, for McKenna, right? And so I'm going to give you this candle. And our hope is that every year on this date, then you'll light this candle for her, remembering, yeah, so I'll give this to you as we, yeah, go ahead. So light this candle every year as a baptismal birthday, reminding her of all the blessings God has given her and celebrate those things. So, receive this burning light to show that you have received Christ, who is the light of the world. Live always in the light of Christ and be ever watchful for his coming, that you may meet him with joy and enter with him into the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which shall have no end, okay? And, all right, let's do this. Now we'll step forward, and I'm gonna let you, here, I'm gonna let you step forward. We're gonna introduce her to the congregation. Yeah, everybody can come on. You can blow that out now. Yeah, go ahead, there we go. Y'all can come back up too. All right, this is our newest sister in Christ congregation. So, and she set up for that. Look at that. She wanted to get a good look at y'all. In holy baptism, God the Father has made you a member of his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and an heir with us of all the treasures of heaven in the one holy Christian and apostolic church. We receive you in Jesus' name as our sister in Christ, that together we might hear his word, receive his gifts, and proclaim the praises of him who has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Amen. We welcome you in the name of the Lord. All right, and let us pray. Almighty and most merciful God and Father, we thank and praise you that you graciously preserve and enlarge your family and have granted McKenna the new birth and holy baptism and made her a member of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and an heir of your heavenly kingdom. We humbly implore you that as she has now become your child, you would keep her in her baptismal grace, that according to your good pleasure, she would faithfully grow to lead the godly life to the praise and honor of your holy name, and finally, with all your saints, obtain the promised inheritance in heaven through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Okay, God's blessings, and you can return to your seat. We'll continue with the rest of our hymn. Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. As part of our preparation for confession, we recite the Ten Commandments together. You shall have no other gods. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Having recited the commandments, we take a moment in silence, reflecting on our sins and our need for that forgiveness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are, by nature, sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord has made known his salvation. He has revealed his righteousness in the sight of the nations.
Let us see, Lord, and all that fills it, the world and those who
let the rivers clap their hands. Let the hills sing for joy together before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above, and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest and peace to his people on earth. You may be seated. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We pray together. O Lord, graciously hear the prayers of your people, that we who justly suffer the consequence of our sin may be mercifully delivered by your goodness to the glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. All right, and having confessed our faith during the baptismal liturgy, we'll continue with our newest memory verse. Wait for it to get here up on the screen. It's coming. All right, 2 Timothy 1:7, we recite together. For the Spirit of God does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. 2 Timothy 1:7. All right, and at this time, we'll continue with our announcements.
Good morning. Sorry about that. I wasn't prepared to skip the creed. Announcements this morning. First of all, and probably most importantly for us today, this morning we will be collecting a door offering on our way out of church to help support Daryl Gersh. As many of you heard, he lost his home to a fire a few weeks ago, and so as his church family, as people who have said that we value loving and caring for other people, we're going to collect a door offering to help him out with that. So, donations, gift cards, If you have physical donations, we can connect you with Daryl for that. But just know that we are collecting for that today. Also coming up this week is the rescheduled ILS open house. So if you or someone you know is interested in our school and what goes on here Monday through Friday and after school and all of those things, our teachers will be available this Wednesday, the 15th, from 6 to 7:15 over in the school. So everyone is welcome to come see the building, see what's going on over there. But just know that that is going on this week. Again, we're doing signups for a new member class. We have lots of big things coming up. A lot of our spring events are coming up. There's an application available. So Friendship Circle sold tamales back in the fall. Hopefully you guys all got some of those and enjoyed those. But their purpose in selling the tamales was to be able to provide a scholarship for an Emmanuel member who intends to go to school at Faith Lutheran next year as a high schooler. So if you are a high schooler or soon to be high schooler who plans to attend Faith Lutheran, there is a scholarship application available in the church office. And then we've been talking about the Lenten devotionals that we have. Ash Wednesday is just a week and a half away. We also have these calendars for families with children. It has every day of Lent, a reading and something to talk about, parents and children or grandparents and children together. So these are now also available in the baskets where the devotionals are. So make sure you grab a devotional if you haven't already. And then if you'd like to take one of these home, these are available for you as well. Anything else? All right, then with that, we will continue to our offering where we give back to God a little bit of what he has given.
Let us pray. God of grace and mercy, you pour out your blessings upon each of us day by day, and we thank you, Lord, for those blessings. And Lord, we ask that you accept these offerings as we give back to you a portion of what you have given us. Lord, we pray that these offerings, as they continue to support the ministries here at Emmanuel, would continue to bless the lives of many. We thank you for this offering that supports the many lives and families that that work here at Emmanuel in response to your gospel call as they serve you in this place. For the upkeep of this facility and all the many ways that it touches the lives of this congregation and community. Continue to well up in us a generosity that gives back to you. We pray for our door offering today for Daryl, and as he has lost his home, that he would feel this love and support as we give to him. We pray that that support would continue to our Ring the Bell building project as we seek to build this new facility, in addition to this facility that will serve this congregation and communities, announcing your presence and providing a place for us to gather. We pray for our other ministries. We pray for the school ministry, of course, and the open house they have, for Durker Circle that meets, and the many ways that they serve so many. For our spring festival, for our school gala, we pray for our upcoming new member class, for those who have thought of joining Emmanuel. We pray your blessings upon all those who meet here. Lord, be with many who we are concerned about. Today we lift up especially Charles Morziowski, John David McComb, and Lord, any others that we take a moment silently to think about today. Lord, you know the needs of each of those that we have concerns for, and we pray that you would bless and strengthen each of them. We pray for those families who have lost loved ones, and today we especially lift up the family of Leroy Grimm, as you've called him home. Lord, we thank you for the faith granted to him, and pray that you would continue to strengthen the family and those who grieve as they look forward to being reunited to him and to all others who have gone before us in faith. We thank you for the gift of baptism, which guarantees that promise and the faith that it grants. And we pray, Lord, that you would continue to bless McKenna and Liv as they are called to those waters of baptism today, and remind us of the blessings that we have in baptism. We celebrate for birthdays with Annie Yankee, myself, Kevin Berry, and Betty Waxwood as birthdays are celebrated. We continue to lift up other ministries, Little Fishers in preschool in Sugarland, St. John Lutheran in Galveston, and Christ Lutheran in Burbank, California. Lord, we pray for these things and all other things on our hearts and minds in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus, who has taught us all to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. Our first reading today is from Deuteronomy chapter 30. See, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I command you today, by loving the Lord your God, by walking in his ways, and by keeping his commandments and his statutes and his rules, then you shall live and multiply. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to take possession of it. But if your heart turns away and you will not hear, but are drawn away to worship other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are going over the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Therefore, choose life, that you and your offspring may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, and holding fast to him. For he is your life, and the length of days that you may dwell in the land that the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's epistle is from 1 Corinthians chapter 3. But I, brothers, could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for it. And even now you are not ready. For you are still of flesh and behaving only in human way. For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not being merely human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you believed, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. He who plants and he who waters are one, and each will receive his wages according to his labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise as you're able. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council. Whoever says, you fool, will be liable to the hell of fire. So if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you're going with him to court, lest your accuser hand you over to the judge and the judge to the guard and you be put in prison. Truly I say to you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said you shall not commit adultery, but I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away, for it is better that you lose one of your members than your whole body be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off, throw it away, for it is better that you lose one of your members than your whole body go into hell. It was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except for the ground of sexual immorality, makes her commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not swear falsely, but shall perform to the Lord what you have sworn. But I say to you, do not take an oath at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not take an oath by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let what you say be simply yes or no. Anything more than this comes from evil. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated.
If any kids would like to come up and join me for a children's message, you can come on up. Good morning. How are you guys this morning? Good. Today we got to have Pastor Tyner read one of my favorite passages from the Bible. Okay. Our epistle reading today from 1 Corinthians is one of my favorite passages from the Bible, especially as someone who works at church. This is what Paul said. Okay, he's getting onto the Corinthians because they're arguing over who they follow. Do they follow Paul? Do they follow a guy named Apollos? That would be like our church member saying, well, I follow Pastor Tyner. No, I follow Pastor Han. Well, actually, I prefer what Miss Katie has to say, so I follow Miss Katie. That's not right, right? That's not what we're about. We're about Jesus. And so what Paul says to the people is that I planted, okay, so he uses a plant as a picture. So what do I have here? Yeah, a cup of dirt, technically soil because it's where it's supposed to be. It's only dirt if it's out of there. My ag teacher would be so proud of me. You I have a little seed starter pot right here, and I probably should ask Mrs. Sigmund's advice on this before I just decided I was going to do this, but make a little hole, right? And Paul says, I planted. So Paul says, I planted the seed. Right? I planted the seed. What does planting the seed do? Maybe. It at least gives it the chance, right? It puts the first thing you need in the ground. Right? And then Paul says, Apollos watered. He probably opened his spray bottle before he watered, huh? Says Apollos watered. All right, now what? You guys planted seeds before? Yes. What do we need now? Okay, the sunlight. Do we control the sunlight? No. So we can have the seed planted. We can give it all the water it needs. But are we in control over whether or not this seed grows? No. No, and that's what Paul says about our faith. Paul says, I can plant seeds. I can tell you about God. Okay, I can introduce you to Jesus. I can tell you what it is to be a Christian. I can plant little seeds of Jesus in your life. Apollos can water that. You guys are being watered right now. Your seeds of faith are being watered right now. By being in church, by hearing God's word, by learning how to pray. You have moms and dads and grandmas and grandpas and all kinds of people that fill up your life, that tell you all the time how loved you are. They show you what God is like. They show you what God's love is like. They're watering you. But here's the thing. We can't make people be Christians. We are not in control over how their faith grows, okay? Which sounds like kind of a bummer, right? Like, I want to be able to make people Christian because I want them to know Jesus. But here's the thing. I am a sinner. And you guys are sinners. And if I'm responsible for people becoming Christians, guess what? They are not going to be Christians. Because if they follow my example, if they follow your example, is that going to show them all the right things to do? No. So thank goodness that God is in charge of our faith. That God's the one who gives us the growth. God is the one who can take what happens at church, like when you're here this morning. He can take the things that you and your parents talk about at home. He can take all of those things and God turns it into faith. God makes you a Christian. God makes you someone who can do what you're supposed to do. Okay? So, a little bit of a bummer at first, but actually a huge blessing. Okay? That we know that we're sinful. But God grows that plant in us. God grows that faith in us. He puts his love in us through all the people he's put in our lives, and then he allows that to grow up into a faith that says, I know Jesus, and I love Jesus, and I know that Jesus loves me. All right? So let's fold our hands and pray, but when we're done praying, don't go anywhere yet, okay? Repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for filling me up with your love and helping me grow in my faith. Thank you for the people in my life that plant the seeds and water it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, before you guys go back to your seats, I do have a little flower pot for each of you and some seeds. Parents, I did consider how mad you might be at me for giving your kids a cup of dirt before they have to sit through the sermon. So the seed bag is a sandwich-sized bag that the pot will fit inside. All right, so you guys can come get a seed while we sing our next hymn.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Will you bow your heads and pray with me? Heavenly Father, grant to me your Holy Spirit that my words would be your words. Grant to your people your Holy Spirit that they would hear your words and be edified by them. In Jesus' name, amen. So in our gospel reading today, Jesus talks a lot about the law. In fact, he elevates the law, and that's saying something, because the laws of the Old Testament were very hard to keep. They're very detailed and very involved. Last year when our Sunday school class was reading through the Bible in a year, we got to Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy really early on. And it was about that point where a lot of people, and everybody does this, a lot of people checked out. The first time I started reading the Bible, when I got to those sections of Scripture, it was hard to keep going. Imagine how hard it was then for the people of those days to actually keep those laws, to know those laws. Now my outlook on those sections of the Bible have changed. I'm kind of a nerd, so those sections interest me, but I just opened my Bible to a random page in Deuteronomy and came across this. These are the animals you may eat: the ox, the sheep, the goat, the deer, the gazelle, the roebuck, the wild goat, the ibex, the antelope, and the mountain sheep. Every animal that parts the hoof and has the hoof cloven in two and chews the cud, among the animals you may eat. Yet those that chew the cud or have the hoof cloven, you shall not eat: the camel, the hare, and the rock badger, because they chew the cud but do not part the hoof, are unclean for you. And the pig, because it parts the hoof but does not chew the cud, is unclean for you. Their flesh you shall not eat, and their carcasses you shall not touch. Pretty riveting, isn't it? But you can't wait to dive into more of that. It's hard to follow along. It's even harder to keep that because of the minute detail, everything you must keep track of. I mean, the people who first received this were slaves fresh out of Egypt. And just imagine for a minute that you're a slave fresh from Egypt. You're free for the first time, able to do whatever you want. Maybe you've had a piece of bacon for the first time, right? And you're, hey, this is great. I'm so glad we're free from Egypt. Have you guys tried this pig animal? This bacon is delicious. Wait, what did he say? Bacon is on the do not eat list? Oh, gosh. Oh, and there are more rules. I have to travel to the tabernacle 3 times a year and bring an animal with me for sacrifice. But what if I'm broke? I still got to do it? And I've got to give 10% of everything I earn to God? Even if I'm broke, I still have to do that? Yeah. And what's up with wandering around the desert for 40 years? Have you guys seen how many people have died while we've been out here? And this place, the people around us, they're really mean. They keep trying to kill us all the time. You know what? Maybe this freedom thing ain't so great. Remember when we were slaves back in Egypt and we had full pots of meat every night? Forget this Moses guy. Let's head on back to Egypt where slavery was great. Now, I took some liberties with the text there, but that's kind of the way it went. Being in the desert, following the law of God is hard. It was hard. And the hardest law of all to follow was the Ten Commandments. That's what Jesus is talking about in our gospel reading today. Now, at first glance, the Ten Commandments don't seem that hard to follow. To use an example, one that Jesus used from our gospel text today, you shall not murder. For most of us, we hear that and it's a big old check mark, right? I've never killed anyone. But Jesus says that anyone who even gets angry with his brother, anyone who insults his brother, anyone who calls somebody a fool is liable to the same judgment as a murderer. Jesus takes those things and elevates them to the same level as committing murder. Jesus hears, he anticipates all of our complaints, all of our what ifs, and kicks them out from under us. It's like the Israelite in the desert. What if I'm broke? Do I still have to do that? Jesus answers with an emphatic yes. He's like the parent making a list of house rules. You know, some of us have this in our house. Maybe it's written on a, a chalkboard or a whiteboard or something. I found one this week. I came across one that was kind of comical, but it's still relatable. Rule number one, no hitting or pushing, right? But the next day, a new rule has to be added. Rule number two, no kicking. Because, of course, kicking wasn't on the list, but mom had only said no hitting and no pushing. I didn't do either one of those things. And then, of course, later that same day, another rule has to be added. No biting. And then it goes on and on. Rule number seven, no throwing toys at people. Rule number 10, no lighting anybody on fire. Until eventually, you can just tell mom is worn out. Rule number 12, no fighting before mom has her coffee. See, the Ten Commandments are God's house rules. So you shall not murder covers all of those other little things that Jesus talks about. It anticipates our complaints. Well, what if I'm just angry with her? It doesn't say anything about insulting anybody. It just says, don't murder. See, Jesus elevates the law. He intensifies the law and shows us the spirit of the law. In these few paragraphs that Pastor Tyner read today, Jesus talks a lot about what shouldn't be done, how we shouldn't behave. The next few paragraphs, if we were to keep reading, talks a lot about what we should do. Jesus takes the law, he intensifies it, and tells us to do that, to keep the elevated law. Because usually our mindset is, what is the bare minimum that I can do and still be called a good Christian? What's the very least that I can do? Jesus answers that question in Matthew 5:48, just a few paragraphs down from our reading today, in the same chapter, in fact. What's the bare minimum that I have to do to be a good Christian? Jesus says, you must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. That is the bare minimum. So that takes away all of the what ifs and the but you only saids. Jesus intensifies the law by laying out the spirit of the law. Be perfect. He leaves no room for any sort of workaround. When it comes to the law, we are always me-focused. What do I have to do? What's the least that I have to do? By telling you to be perfect, Jesus is also telling you something else. Don't be me-focused. That's impossible. Instead, Jesus says, be cross-focused. Because by looking at that cross where Jesus hung and died, only then can you realize that, yes, Jesus intensifies the law. He makes it so that you cannot keep the law. Be perfect, he says. Even though he does that, by looking at the cross, you realize that he doesn't leave you in that spot. Jesus is the image of the invisible God. He tells you to be perfect as his heavenly Father is perfect. Jesus is perfect as the heavenly Father is perfect. But he doesn't hold that perfection for himself. When you focus on the cross, you can realize what Jesus has done for you. If he wanted to, Jesus could have picked himself up off of that cross. He could have stepped down and kept that perfection all for himself, but he didn't. He hung there. He bled and he died. And he did that for you. And on that cross, he became imperfect. He became sin. In the eighth grade class, I have a little cup set up, a little cup in there, where they can write a question and put it in the cup, so it's kind of anonymous. I can come in there, I can take the question out, see what it is, answer any questions that they may have about the Bible. And in the couple months that I've had that set up, there's only been one question asked. And that was actually this week. And the question was, when Jesus was a kid, did he have growing pains? Did he get sick? And the simple answer to that question, the quick answer to that question is, I don't know. Scripture does not tell that to us. But there's actually a question behind that question. You see, disease, sickness, pain, these are all effects of sin. They're all results of sin. And so to the question behind the question is actually, did Jesus suffer the effects of sin? Now, as he was growing up, I don't know. Even when he was a man, I don't know if he got sick. I don't know if he experienced pain. Scripture just doesn't tell us that. But I do know that on the cross, he did suffer the effects of sin. On the cross, where he became sin, he felt pain. He took all of the sickness that you would feel, all of the shame, all of the pain, all of the imperfection that belongs to you, Jesus took on himself. He became sin who knew no sin, that in him we might become the righteousness of God. On that cross, he took your imperfection. On that cross, he gave you his perfection. Be cross-focused. It's because of that cross, by the death and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you don't have to strive to be perfect. Because by that cross, you were made perfect. Keeping the law is hard. You cannot do it. Jesus did it for you. Jesus elevated the law. He intensified the law to show us the spirit of the law. Murder isn't just killing someone. It's also being angry with someone. It's insulting someone. When you're me-focused, the spirit of the law is to show you your sin, to show you your imperfections, to show you that you cannot live up to the expectations that God, that Jesus has laid before you. You cannot be perfect. Cross-focused Christians, though, see the love of Jesus. And that's the true spirit of the law for Christians. Love. The law focuses you away from yourself and toward your neighbor, toward God. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. When you focus on the cross and see the love of Jesus, and how it has made you perfect, you desire to show that love to everyone else. As the love of Jesus transforms you, you desire to transform others with the love of Jesus. You are Christians. That's just what you do. And when you're cross-focused, the house rules of God no longer become a burden that we have to try to work around, figure out what the bare minimum is. Instead, they become a guidebook of how to have a better relationship with Jesus and how to have a better relationship with our neighbor. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God now becomes, I get to call on the name of God in every trouble. I get to pray praise and give thanks. You shall not murder isn't just don't hurt your neighbor. It now becomes, how can I help my neighbor in his physical body? How can I help my neighbor in everything that he or she needs? Being cross-focused means striving to be perfect, not for yourself, but for your neighbor. You can't be perfect for yourself because Jesus has already done that for you. In the eyes of God, you are perfect. Now you're trying to be perfect for your neighbor. You're trying to do everything you can to help your neighbor. Those who are cross-focused, you Christians, try to transform your neighbor with the love of Jesus because the love of Jesus has already transformed you. In Jesus' name, amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep and guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus from now to life everlasting. Amen. Please rise and receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen.